morning children, my class. Today we are going to revise chapter 2, element compound and mixture. This chapter we have finished already, but today we are going to revise it. Okay, so first part today we are going to revise, and I want to tell you something. In our previous class I told you that I will be providing the curriculum which you can get in the council's website also, but today I will be giving that. Last day it was not possible to upload, but today you will be getting that, okay, the curriculum. So curriculum you have to follow, and we will be following the curriculum only, because in your textbook maybe some few things are extra which you need not to do that, okay. So you just follow the curriculum, whatever things are there, that only we are going to learn and read. If you want to do extra you can, but we will be following the curriculum, okay. So let's start the revision. I hope in our previous classes whatever I taught you understood that properly. If not, then today again I will be trying to do that to make you understand the whole chapter, okay. So in two parts we are going to do that. Today the first part we will be doing, okay. So let's start. Elements, compounds and mixtures. So today we are going to discuss matter, elements, symbols of elements, first 20 elements and the symbols, classification of elements with examples, compounds and its characteristics, molecules of compounds, verification of compounds and differences between elements and compounds. Matter, what is that? Matter is nothing but a substance which can occupy some space, which can be touched or perceived by our senses. Okay, so matter can be of two types, one is living, another is non-living. Living matter is plants and animals, which you are going to read about them, you are going to learn about them in biology. And non-living matter, these are natural, maybe natural and maybe man-made, both can be there. They again can be of two types, one is pure substances, another is impure substances. We are going to work with this in chemistry. We are going to work with the non-living substances, matter. Okay. Though in organic substances, it's having it's made up of living things, but generally now we are going to discuss this non-living matter. Okay. So pure substances and impure substances, these two parts are there, these two types are there. Pure substances are those substances which are, by the name only you can get to know that they will contain only one kind of substances, one kind of particles. That's why these are called pure, and these will these pure substances are always homogeneous. This homogeneous term, this is new to you. This is what homo means, same, and genus means its texture, its appearance or its composition, you can say. Okay, so pure substances are always homogeneous, means they are the particles in pure substances, they will be distributing in the volume properly or uniformly, we can say. Okay, the constituent particles composition will be same everywhere. Okay, they will be equally distributed throughout the substance, whereas heterogeneous substances, which we will get in the impure substances, this you can say as hetero means different. So heterogeneous means the appearance or the composition will be different. It's not same everywhere, like mud particles, like muddy water we can say. If we consider muddy water, then we will see everywhere the composition of the particles are not same. Somewhere the particles, concentration of the particles are more, somewhere the concentration of the particles are less. That means the appearance is not same everywhere. The composition is not same everywhere. The particles are not equally distributed everywhere in the substance or in the mixture, whatever you can say. So that means its composition is not same everywhere, so it is called heterogeneous. Okay, now pure substances, they can be element to again this can be classified into two groups, elements and compounds. Elements again can be classified into metals, non-metals, metalloids and noble gases. Okay, and impure substances, they can be homogeneous or heterogeneous, and mixtures are a type of impure substances. Next, element, its definition is: an element is defined as a pure substance made up of only one kind of atoms that cannot be converted into anything simpler than itself by any physical or chemical process. Element is defined as a pure substance. It is a pure substance as an element is having only one kind of particle made up of only one kind of atoms. Okay, atoms are the particles. Atoms are the smallest particles which will be there in a in an element. If we try to break a piece of element, any element, see here iron, gold, copper, these are the metals, these are the elements you can say. Now if we break any one of these three or any element, if we try to break, then after if we continue the breaking process, we are going to get smaller particles of that element, and after going through this process, if we continue with this process, this breaking process, we will come to a situation, we will come to a point where the particle will be too small that we cannot break it anymore. Then that particle will be called an atom. That means the smallest particle of each and every element is called an atom. It cannot be converted into anything simpler. That means we cannot break it anymore than itself by any physical or chemical process. Okay, so element is defined as a pure substance. It is a pure substance. It is a pure substance which is made up of only one kind of atoms, one kind of particles that cannot be converted into anything simpler than itself. We cannot break the atom. Okay, by any physical or chemical process, by any process we cannot break it. We cannot break that. Okay, next, symbol of elements. There are 118 elements together, but those elements we cannot always write down its name, its full name. It's not practical. We cannot use the full name everywhere because we need to work with the elements, we need to represent them. So to represent them, we have to represent them with a symbol. Okay, and a symbol is an abbreviation for a chemical element. It's a small name of the which comes from the proper name or the full name of an element. Symbols for chemical elements normally consist of one or two letters from the Latin alphabet and are written with the first letter capitalized. That means the Latin name or the normal name which are there for the symbol, which are there for the elements, from the name we will be taking the first letter and one the we can take the first letter only, or sometimes first letter and one more letter we can take, okay, as a symbol. Now hydrogen, this is the first element. We have done the first 20 elements. So the first element, you know that this is hydrogen. So by the name only, from the name of hydrogen, we will be taking the first letter H as a symbol of hydrogen. So symbol of hydrogen will be H. In this manner only. For oxygen, this is oxygen gas, you know. So the first letter O from oxygen we will be taking as a symbol of oxygen. So O is the symbol of oxygen. In the same manner, for carbon we will be taking C as symbol of carbon. Now calcium, here carbon and calcium both starts with the same letter, cell alphabet, same alphabet C. Then what to do? For carbon we have already taken the symbol as C, so C again we cannot write. For calcium, then we cannot recognize this two separately, we cannot distinguish this two. So for calcium we will be taking Ca, the first letter along with the second letter, but the second letter will be in small letter, okay. So Ca will be the symbol for calcium. For cobalt, in the same manner, Co, okay. For copper, we will be taking the Latin name. Cuprum is the Latin name for copper. So Cu is the symbol, okay. For sodium, natrium is the Latin name for sodium. So Na is the symbol of sodium. Otherwise, we should have taken S for sodium, but S already we have taken for sulfur, okay. So for sodium we cannot use the same letter, okay. So for that we will be taking the first two letter of its Latin name, natrium. So Na is the symbol of sodium. Here is the first 20 elements and their symbols. You know this, hope you have practiced this and you have memorized. So symbol of hydrogen H, then helium He, this is the second element, lithium Li, beryllium Be, boron. In this manner the symbols of first 20 elements, this you have to memorize properly, okay. Let's move on. Classification of elements. Elements can be classified into these four groups: metals, which are having example as iron and gold. Metals, you know, these are hard. They will have metallic shine, metallic luster is there. Generally, metals are good conductor of heat and electricity. They are malleable and ductile, means we can make a very thin sheet of it. And metallic sheets, you know, aluminium sheet or gold foil, these are there. So metal, as these are hard, they cannot break down easily. So if you want, we can make a very thin sheet of it, okay. So this is called malleable. And ductile means we can make a very long wear from a metal, piece of metal, okay. A very thin long wear we can make. So this is called ductility, this property of metal. Whereas non-metals are generally soft. Generally the gases are non-metals: hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, chlorine, these are there, sulfur, this is a solid non-metal. So these are non-metal, they are having property just opposite to the metal, though some exceptions are there. Those exceptions are very, very important. We have done already in the study material, you will be getting that, so you have to do that properly, okay. liquid metal, liquid metal, or the non-metal, which is a good conductor of electricity, which is an exception. These are there. Okay, hope you have done that properly. Next, metalloid, they are having few property similar to metal and few properties similar to non-metal. So these are called metalloid. Arsenic, antimony, silicon, boron, these are the examples of metalloid. Next, noble gas. Noble gas or inert gas also we can say. There are six gases which are called noble gas because they are inert, they are non-reactive, they don't react generally because they are stable. Okay, so helium, neon, these two examples are given here. Other than these two, argon, krypton, xenon and radon, these four are also there. These are called noble gases. Okay, next, compound. So definition of compound can be given as, these are also the pure substances like elements formed by the chemical combination of two or more elements in a definite proportion by mass. That means these compounds are also pure substances like elements, but when elements will combine together, two or more elements, when they will be chemically combined together in a definite proportion by mass, they will be forming a compound. That means, suppose if we take an example of water, H2O, we know water. So in water we will be getting two elements, hydrogen and oxygen. So when hydrogen and oxygen will chemically combine together in a fixed ratio by mass, in a fixed proportion by mass, they will be forming a whole new substance. That substance is called a compound. Okay, so here two pure substances, oxygen and hydrogen, combine together chemically, and this combination will be in a definite proportion by mass. Two hydrogen atom and one oxygen atom will be there in a single water molecule. Okay, compounds are made up of different types of atoms combined chemically to form molecule. The properties of a compound are entirely different from those of its constituent elements. That means in a compound, whatever elements are there, the elements will lose their individual properties when they will be forming a compound. That means when the elements will form a compound, in a compound they will be lost their property, they will be losing their property, and compound's property will be entirely different than those of its constituent elements. Here is the characteristic of compound. What are the characteristics? It consists of two or more elements. This we know already. The constituting elements of a compound are combined in a definite proportion in every sample of the compound. What is this? As we have taken the example of water. So water, if we collect from any source, we may take the water from pond, we can collect the rain water, we can collect the sea water, we can collect the water from tube well and all. So from anywhere we can collect the sample of water, but the composition of water will be same. H2O will be the chemical formula of it, and the proportion of the elements which are present in water in that compound, here hydrogen and oxygen, these two elements are there, their proportion will be same everywhere. For each of the sample, the proportion will be same. That means in all the samples of water, hydrogen and oxygen's proportion will be 2:1. Two hydrogen atom and one oxygen atom will be there. Okay, so compound, it is pure and homogeneous. Why it is pure? Because the suppose if we take one glass of water, then in that water, in that amount of water, we will be having several molecules of water. Okay, so many molecules of water will be there present in that one glass of water. Okay, but everywhere the particles of water H2O, this will be same. This will be same means only this H2O particles will be there present in the water, in the glass of water. No other particles will be there. That means same type of particles are there in water, in that compound. For every compound this is true, so it is pure, as we are getting only one kind of particle. And as the composition of water is same everywhere, so it will be homogeneous also. Everywhere the concentration or the spreading of the particles, or the as it is showing in that manner, okay, the particle or the molecule of water, they will be arranged, the arrangement of the particles, it will be same everywhere. Its distribution will be same, so it is homogeneous, it's look alike only. Okay, throughout the volume of water, this will be, the arrangement of the particles will be same, the distribution of the particles will be same, the composition of the particles will be same. So these are called homogeneous. Next, the physical and chemical properties of compound differ from those of its constituent elements. Physical properties of compound differ from those of its constituent elements means after getting a compound, the constituent elements will lose their individual properties, and in a compound there will be a whole new set of properties will be there. This part, this characteristic, we will be discussing afterwards later. Okay, with some examples we will be discussing this this point. Okay, the components of a compound cannot be separated by simple physical means. That means we cannot separate the separate hydrogen and oxygen from water by simple physical means. By simple physical means like boiling or evaporation, this process, or heating, this process are just some simple physical means. So using this we cannot separate them. For that we have to use critical chemical processes. Like for water, to separate the constituent of water, means the hydrogen and oxygen, to separate them we have to use electrolysis process. Okay, so this is a chemical process, it's not simple physical process. Energy is either absorbed or evolved when a compound is formed. That means during the formation of a compound, energy changes must. Energy may be absorbed or may be evolved. Next, molecules of compounds. Molecules means when two or more atoms will combine together with chemical bond. Chemically, when they will be combined together, then we are going to get the molecules. So compounds, as they are having two or more elements in them, so the molecules of compound will be in a molecule of compound there will be two or more atoms. Okay, two or more different kind of elements, and their atoms will be there. See here in the first picture we are getting the figure of water molecule. This red color ball, this is oxygen, and this yellowish ball, this represents hydrogen. See, it's written also, these two are two hydrogens. So two hydrogen atom, this single, these are called hydrogen atoms, and this is oxygen atom. And when this three will be together, sorry, when this three will be together, this along with this oxygen, hydrogen and oxygen and two hydrogens, they will be forming the molecule of a compound water, H2O. So when they will be separated, single oxygen, this hydrogen, two hydrogens, they will be called as atoms. And when they will be combined together and combined with this bond, chemical bond, see, these two are two bonds. Through this bond, this oxygen and hydrogen will be attached together. So when they will be attached together with the chemical bond, means they will be combined chemically, we will be getting a molecule of compound. In the same manner, here we can see the molecule of carbon dioxide, this red color. Generally with red we will be representing oxygen, okay, with black or gray we will be representing carbon. So this is the middle one is carbon, and these two are two oxygen atoms. So they will be combining together with the bonds. See, this black color sticks, like these are chemical bonds for carbon dioxide. So they will be forming the molecule of carbon dioxide, two oxygen atom and one carbon atom. The proportion of carbon is to oxygen, the number of atoms of carbon is to oxygen will be 1:2, one carbon atom and two oxygen atom. For calcium oxide, see, this is oxygen, this is calcium. One calcium atom, one oxygen atom, they will be combining together to form calcium oxide. For nitrogen dioxide, this middle one, this blue color ball, this is nitrogen, and this two red color ball is two oxygen. So one nitrogen and two oxygen, they will be combining together with a chemical bond to form nitrogen dioxide, NO2. This is zinc chloride. Zinc, the middle one, this particle, this particle represents zinc, which is a metal. And this two purple color, violet color, we can say violet color ball or particle, this represents chlorine. Okay, so one zinc and two chlorine atoms are there, and they will be forming the compound 7CH2, zinc chloride. Okay, next, see, verification of characteristic of compound. How we will verify the characteristic of compound? Here we have taken the example of water. Formation of water is there. Here we have taken two hydrogen molecule. See, this is one hydrogen molecule, this is one hydrogen molecule, and in each hydrogen molecule there are two hydrogen atoms. See, this is one, this is one. This is one hydrogen atom, and this is another hydrogen atom. Two hydrogen atoms will combine together to form one hydrogen molecule. So H2, we will be representing the hydrogen molecule as H2. This 2 is for two hydrogen atoms. That means this 2 represents that in a single hydrogen molecule there will be two hydrogen atoms. So in this manner, two hydrogen molecules we have taken, one and one, two hydrogen molecules we have taken, that will react with another oxygen atom, another oxygen molecule. So for oxygen also, two in a single oxygen molecule there will be two oxygen atoms. So this is one, this is one. Okay, now with two hydrogen atom, one atom of oxygen will combine and they will form like this. They will be bonded together like this, as we have seen in the previous, just a few minutes ago, we have seen that with the chemical bond they will be combining together and they will form the molecule of water. So this is oxygen and these two are the hydrogen atoms. So like this, two water molecules we will be getting, because we are having two oxygen atoms and four hydrogen atoms. So they will be combining together to form 2 H2O. Now this H2O, this when it will produce the water from hydrogen and oxygen, when these two will combine together, this let us discuss the properties of hydrogen a bit. Hydrogen is a gas and it is inflammable. Okay, hydrogen can be used as a fuel. So hydrogen gas itself, it will burn. If we light it, if we put fire on it, it will catch fire and it will burn itself. So we can use it as fuel. So hydrogen is a gas, it can be it's inflammable. Okay, whereas oxygen helps in burning. The burning process cannot be done, cannot happen if there will be no oxygen, okay, in that manner. So hydrogen and oxygen, these two are having this property. It will burn itself and it will help in burning. Whereas water, this helps us to put off the fire. Okay, so that means the property of water is totally different from that of its constituent elements. And anywhere from anywhere we can collect the hydrogen and oxygen, and the water which we will be getting after reacting this two, the proportion of water will be same. Okay, two hydrogen atom and one oxygen atom. So this is also the characteristic, one of the characteristic of compound. Okay, and during the formation of water, we will be getting that during this reaction, heat and light will be involved. Okay, that means energy will be involved in this process. So this is another characteristic of compound. So we can say that after reacting oxygen and hydrogen, the water which we are getting, that is a compound. Next, verification of characteristic of compound in the same manner as we did sodium. It's a soft metal and it's very much reactive, whereas chlorine is a greenish yellow gas and this is also reactive and it is poisonous. Both sodium and chlorine, both are poisonous. But after reacting these two, when we are getting the sodium chloride, this is common salt or table salt, which we use regularly in our food to increase the test. That is non-poisonous. As we are having this, as we are using this in our food, that means these are non-poisonous. But whereas these elements, constituent elements like chlorine and sodium, these two both are poisonous. That means they are having totally different characteristic than that of the compound formed. Okay, so this is the verification that sodium chloride, it is a compound. For sulfur and iron also we can say the same thing. If we take some sulfur, this is a non-metal, and sulfur can be dissolved in carbon disulfide. This is the property of sulfur, whereas iron, it will get attracted by magnet. As it is a magnetic substance, so it will get attracted by magnet. Now if we add this two, and if we heat the mixture, then after some time we will be getting a black mass, that is ferrosulfide, FeS. Now in this ferrosulfide, if we add carbon disulfide, it cannot dissolve it. Okay, it will be seeing in the worksheet also, in the question paper also, in the worksheet you will be getting a question which is related to this. Why the ferrous sulfide, it will not dissolve in carbon sulfide if we add carbon sulfide in it. Sulfur and iron, when these two will be mixed together. In this test tube we have taken sulfur and here we have taken iron, and here we will be taking the mixture of sulfur and iron. Now sulfur, the property of sulfur can be given as it will be dissolved in carbon disulfide and form a solution, and the property of iron is it will get attracted by magnet. Now when we will be heating the mixture of iron and sulfur, we are going to get ferrous sulfide. This is a compound. Now ferrous sulfide is having a totally different property than that of its constituent elements sulfur and iron. Means if we add carbon disulfide in ferrous sulfide, it will not dissolve in it and it will remain insoluble in carbon disulfide. And if we bring a magnet to this ferrous sulfide, it will not get attracted by the magnet as well. That means from this we can prove that iron and sulfur both have lost their properties after forming the compound ferrous sulfide. So this is the characteristic of compound, we can say that after forming the compound, the constituent elements will lose their properties and we will be getting a whole new property for the compound. Okay, next, what is the difference between element and compound? The first difference is both element and compound both are pure substances. Elements are pure substances which are composed of only one type of atom, whereas compound are substances, pure substances only, which are formed by two or more different types of elements that are united chemically in fixed proportions. Okay, so both are pure substances, but in elements there will be only one type of atom, one type of particles, whereas two or more different type of elements will be combined together, will be united chemically in fixed ratio, fixed proportion to form the compound. Next, elements are classified as either metals, non-metals or metalloids, noble gases, whereas compounds are classified according to their bonds, which can be ionic, molecular or metallic. There are the bond in chemical bonds may be of ionic, molecular or metallic. So according to the bonds compounds are classified. Next, elements are represented by symbols and numbers. For example, sodium is represented by Na. Na is the symbol for sodium. So to represent element we will be using the symbols, whereas compounds are represented by their chemical formula. For example, salt is represented by the formula NaCl. NaCl is the chemical formula for the compound sodium chloride. Here both the symbol of sodium and symbol of chlorine has been used. As only one type of atoms make up an element, all the properties of that element are represented by its atom. That means in the atom, in the smallest particle of the element, that will represent all the properties of that element. That means in the atom, we can get all the properties of that particular element. That means a piece of gold is having whatever properties, the properties of gold, but the same properties we are going to get in the atom of gold. Okay, whereas in case of compounds, the same type of molecules makes up the compound. In a compound, suppose a compound of suppose water. So in a glass of water, all the molecules of H2O water will be there. So this H2 molecules are same type of molecule, that's why we will be calling compound as a pure substance again. Okay, though it is formed with the chemical combination of two or more elements, but it is a pure substance. Elements cannot be broken down by chemical reactions, whereas compounds can be easily separated into simpler substances by chemical reactions. Different chemical reactions are there, so using those we can separate the compound to its constituent elements. Okay, so this is all for today. Now here you pause the video and you just go through this properly, whether you are getting this or not, and then bring a pen and paper and we are going to discuss the worksheet, the last worksheet which was given. Okay, so let's do that. So from exercise 1, the first one was select homogeneous and heterogeneous mixtures from the following. So homogeneous means throughout the volume the particles cannot be seen separately, its composition will be same everywhere, altogether its composition will be same, whereas heterogeneous is just opposite to that. So according to that we will be classifying these solutions, these examples. Okay, so you have to make two columns for homogeneous and for heterogeneous, and then we will be putting these substances in the columns accordingly. Salt solution, this is homogeneous because composition is same everywhere. Petrol and water, these are immiscible, they cannot mix together, they will form two separate layers, so this will be heterogeneous. Sand and charcoal, this is also heterogeneous because sand and charcoal, if we mix together, they cannot mix properly. We can easily identify which one is sand and which one is charcoal. Okay, alcohol and water, this is homogeneous because they will form a miscible mixture, miscible liquid. Alcohol and water are miscible liquid. Air dissolved in water, this is also homogeneous because we cannot see the air separately in water. Air, this is also homogeneous. Sea water also we can say it's salty water, so this is also homogeneous, we will say. Okay, fruit juices, this is also homogeneous. Okay, mist is heterogeneous, and brass, this is an alloy, it's a mixture of copper and zinc. Brass is copper and zinc, mixture of copper and zinc, so it's an alloy and this is a homogeneous mixture. Now define the following with an example for each. This part no need to do. Okay, define the following, this no need to do. Achha, list four characteristics of a mixture. This characteristic of mixture you can write your own. Next, give reason. Why do sugar and water retain their individual properties in a sugar solution? This you just I'm discussing the answer, but you write in your own word. Okay? So why do sugar and water retain their individual properties in a sugar solution? As sugar solution is a mixture, it's not a compound. So in sugar solution, the individual component, the constituent substances, they will retain their property. Both of their properties will be there. They will show their properties in a mixture because they are not chemically combined there. Okay, no chemical combination is there in a mixture. So sugar solution is not a mixture. Sugar solution is not a compound. It's a mixture. So in mixture, the constituent substances retain their individual properties. Next, why do petrol and water form a heterogeneous mixture? Because just now we have discussed petrol and water, these two are immiscible liquids. If we mix these two, then petrol and water, it will form two separate layers. As petrol is light in weight, so it will float on water, and water will form the lower layer. Okay, so as the composition is not same everywhere, so it will be a heterogeneous mixture. As these are immiscible, so these are, we can separate the substances, we can separate the constituent, and separately we can recognize them. So these are heterogeneous mixture. This mixture of petrol and water is a heterogeneous mixture. Why does sulfur dissolve when carbon disulfide is added to a mixture of iron and sulfur, but not when it is added to iron sulfide? So what is the question? Why does sulfur dissolve when carbon disulfide is added to a mixture of iron and sulfur? In a mixture of iron and sulfur are not chemically bonded together. That means in a mixture of iron and sulfur, the elements iron and sulfur both retain their individual properties, and so sulfur dissolves when carbon disulfide is added to the mixture of iron and sulfur. But when it is added to iron sulfide, as iron sulfide is a it's a compound, so the individual property of sulfur and iron will be lost. Okay, so in this compound, sulfur has lost its property, so now it no longer get dissolved in carbon disulfide. Okay, so hope you can write your own. Okay, next, give two examples for each of the following type of mixture. Solid-solid mixture, many are there, like salt and sugar, rice and pearls, any two you can write, sand and iron and sand you can write, sugar and sand you can write, any two you can write. Okay, solid liquid mixture, here you can write salt and sugar, salt and water, liquid should be there. Okay, so solid is salt and water is liquid. So salt and water, sugar and water, any, these are homogeneous mixture. If you want to write heterogeneous mixture, then you can write sand and water, or you can write water with anything which is insoluble in water. That you can write chalk dust and water, husk and water can be given. Okay, liquid and gas, for this you can write as tap water, liquid and gas, or ammonia in gas you can write, or carbonated drink you can write. There carbon dioxide and water, carbon dioxide and the liquid is there. Okay, gas mixture, air can be there, or you can write any two, the mixture of any two gas, like oxygen and nitrogen you can write, chlorine and oxygen you can write, or any two gas mixture you can write here. Okay, next, name the components. This part no need to do. Okay, so question number 6 and question number 2, this you just omit. Okay, as it was there in the exercise, so I have given, but this it's not there in that manner in the syllabus, so let it be, no need to do this too. So 2 and 6. Okay, next, state 3 differences between water and air that you will be getting in your study material which was given. Okay, so just I'm telling one thing, water is a compound and air is a mixture, so the differences between compound and mixture will be there. Okay, so you have to write accordingly. Now 4 differences between compound and mixture, this also you will be getting in the study material, so from there you can write. Okay, so one more exercise is also there, but today up to this only. Next day we will be doing exercise 2 and rest of all. Okay, so just this is all for today. This is all for today, students. You just study properly, you just go through the study material, do the worksheets properly, you just solve this. Okay, and in today's worksheet we will be we are going to do some activity on the atoms are there, atoms and these molecules are there, so you have to make some model of atom and molecule. Okay, so this is very easy. I will be telling you how to do that. So using ball and stick model we will be doing those. Okay, so this is all for today. Take care. Thank you.